himself, too often we easily judge others, examine others' lives. But as we approach the table of the Lord, we are exhorted in God's word to examine ourselves. Is our life right with the Lord? Do we have an intimate walk with Him? Do we desire to praise Him, worship Him, hear His voice, and have that close relationship with Him? I'd like to read a portion of the Word of God as we start to meditate and think about approaching the Lord's table from 1 Corinthians 11, verse 23.
Spiritual aspect where the whole
Holy Spirit comes into our life, works through the world, through the gospel, as that small mustard seed then grows. But what Jesus is talking about here is not the spiritual aspect of the kingdom. He's talking about the physical, literal kingdom when he comes again. He says, I will not drink from this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. So he's pointing forward. Usually when we come to the Lord's table, we think back to the crucifixion, how Jesus' broken body, his blood shed on the cross. But there's an aspect of this that Jesus is talking about, which is eschatological, that is looking to the future. And Jesus is saying, I'm not going to drink this wine, this fruit of the vine, again with you, until I drink it in my Father's kingdom. So he's pointing to a time when he again will drink with his disciples, and not only the 12, well, 11, because Jesus was not a faithful disciple, but with the 11 that were there, that were faithful disciples, not only with them, but with us, all the believers gathered together. And at that time when he will drink again with us, I believe will be at the banquet. The wedding banquet. Just as Jesus went to that wedding at Cana and was at the banquet and provided fruit of the vine when the grape juice ran out, he will again provide for us at the banquet, the wedding banquet. I'd like to look at that just briefly before we come to the Lord's table. The marriage of the Lamb is based on the Jewish marriage tradition. He was a Jew, born of Joseph and Mary. We know Mary was the mother. Joseph was the stepfather, not the real father, because the Holy Spirit came and impregnated Mary. But he was a Jew, and so the wedding ceremony and marriage that will take place for church will be based on Jewish tradition. So first we have the bride price, the payment of the bride price by the groom. You are bought with a price. So when we consider the 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 20, and Paul is speaking to those people, he's saying you are not your own. You are bought with a price. And this is the language of the groom who pays the bride price. And it was Jesus who's paid his own precious blood to redeem us and to buy us out of this fallen world. And then Paul says, 2 Corinthians 11, verse 2, I have espoused you as a virgin. In other words, you, what we would say in America, maybe in England, you are engaged to be married. The person whom you're going to marry, get married to, is already chosen. You don't go out on dates or look for someone else for some sort of relationship between men and women, because that espousal, that engagement, means that this is the person you will marry and you will remain faithful to them even prior to the wedding ceremony. So Paul is emphasizing this to the Corinthians. You are espoused. You are engaged. You do not have the liberty to do as it pleases yourself, because the bride, the groom, has purchased you with a bride price. You already belong to him. And then there is the time of preparation, the second stage, when Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you and will come again. The Jews knew just what he was talking about, because the groom, after the espousal, the engagement, the groom would go to prepare a place for he and his wife to live. He made all the preparation, get saying to his bride, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. And he is making the way, paying the price to have this exclusive relationship. And then he says, I go to prepare a place for you and will come again. We're going to look at this more tonight when we look at the rapture and the coming of Jesus Christ for his bride. The third stage is the wedding feast. Jesus said, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine until I drink it in my Father's kingdom. And so this is the last time that Jesus will drink of the vine with his disciples. And the next time, as I said already, he will drink with not only those disciples that were at the table with him, but with all of those believers who have been espoused and engaged to him. It is the final ceremony that takes place. So this verse comes from the time when Jesus was at the Passover feast. At the Passover feast with his disciples, which we could say is the first communion, the first table that where he shared his broken body and blood symbolically with the bread and the wine. So as we come to this table this morning, as we examine ourselves, we can ask ourselves the question, are we faithful in our espoused relationship with Jesus? Or is there something else in our life, something of compromise, that where we are unfaithful to him, disobedient to his word, disobedient in the relationship that we have with him? The early marriage, earthly marriage, was a type of the heavenly marriage. Remember, Adam in Genesis chapter 2 was alone. He was the only person on the earth. And God has created us as social beings. That means we desire to interact, to talk with one another, to socialize, to have events together, to gather together as a body for church. And so Adam was alone, and God said this was not good. God knew the condition of Adam by himself. So from his side, God took a rib and formed the woman Eve from the side of Adam. Just how he did that, I don't know. But it was from the body of Adam. In a like manner, the heavenly marriage, Jesus, the groom, pays the bride price as the blood is poured from his side to purchase the bride. Peter says that they're not redeemed with corruptible things such as silver and gold, but with a precious blood of Christ as a lamb without spot or blemish. So the bride price that Jesus paid is not an earthly price like gold or silver or pounds or dollars or some form of monetary value. Peter says these things are corruptible, silver and gold. They will perish. But we are redeemed with the precious blood of Christ. We are purchased by the groom with his precious blood from his side, his hands, his feet. So he has paid the price. You are not your own. You are bought with a price. And so this morning, as we think of the table, preparing to come to the table, as we examine ourselves, we need to answer that question. Are we faithful to the bridegroom, as who has paid, already paid, this high bride price for us? The patriarchs went far land to retrieve a suitable bride, for example, Isaac and Jacob. They were told not to take of the brides of the Canaanites. So they went to the ancestors of Abraham, and they'd select their wives from the Abraham's clan. Jesus went to a farm and to purchase his bride. He came from eternity, took on flesh as a man, and then offered his body as sacrifice to pay the price for his bride. Jesus went to a far land to get his bride from the glory of heaven to the sin cursed earth. Hosea the prophet married a loose woman who was unfaithful and adulterous. And he wanted to know, should I divorce this woman? She has been unfaithful. And God said, keep her as your wife. Because in this relationship, it pictured God's faithfulness despite Israel's unfaithfulness. He remained faithful to his wife. He could have divorced her. But even though Israel was disobedient, and the Lord looks at Israel as his bride as well as looking at us in the church, even when she is disobedient, he is forgiving and graceful. Communion, or the Lord's table, goes by many different names. We remember that we are bought with a price, the precious blood of Christ, 1 Peter 1:18. You're not redeemed with corruptible things such as silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ. We remember that we are espoused as a virgin to one husband, Christ. Does that conviction enter our heart that we are already espoused or engaged, and we have a commitment to Christ to be faithful to his word, and not just to get involved in worldly pursuits and worldly things, but give the Lord Jesus Christ the priority. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. What are the priorities of our life? We all have such a busy schedule. Almost every day we have a list of things we want to get done, and many days we don't get all those things accomplished. But in that long list of things to do, where does the Lord Jesus Christ come? Is he the first one at the top of the list? We get up, we have a Bible reading, some time of prayer, devotion, set our mind on him. In our love relationship with him, looking forward to that day when the wedding ceremony will take place. Or we get up, we're already late, rush, only had a little bit of breakfast, start down on our things to do list. And maybe at the end of the day, there's a little bit of time left over. Maybe we have a few thoughts about the Lord, maybe a couple Bible verses, maybe some prayer. Life is so busy. Jesus said that there are four different types of soil that the word of God falls on. Remember the parable of the sower. And the third type of soil was amongst the thorns. And the seed, the word of God, fell amongst the thorns, and it tried to grow. But as it tried to grow, it was very difficult because these thorns of this plant were surrounding it and cutting it off from the sunlight and taking the water and nutrition from the soil. And the disciples came and said to Jesus, what does this mean, these different types of soil and the seed falling down? And Jesus said, this third kind is the cares of this world. Cares of this world. And when the seed, the word of God, comes, it grows. It starts to grow. But all these other things, this list of things to do, zap the life, take the life out of the plant of this seed. And it doesn't grow to maturity and produce fruit. Only the last seed that fell into the fertile soil produced 30, 60, 100-fold fruit for the kingdom and for the glory of God. I think today the church has many of those plants that are in amongst the thorns. The seed has fallen, it's taken root, it's started to grow, but it is so difficult to have the plant come to maturity and have fruit, flowers and fruit, because of these thorns that surround this seed that is trying to grow. As we think again towards the table, what is our priority in life? Are we the good seed, the good soil, where the seed falls and produces 30, 60, 100 fold? The evidence of the working of the Holy Spirit, Galatians 5:22, is evident in our life. Love, joy, peace, so forth. This fruit is evident. Like in Daniel's life, we looked at last night, it was evident, it could be seen, that this young man, Daniel, had a relationship with God. And his testimony was powerful enough to convict this heathen king, the most powerful man in the world, Nebuchadnezzar. Is that our life today? Can we say that Jesus is the priority in our life, the first priority? And we come to the table by faith. We remember his sacrifice for us. We remember that we are espoused or engaged to him, and we are faithful to him, waiting for his coming and praying for his kingdom. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Lord, I want to see you. Maranatha, the Lord comes. So as we look forward, we look to the time that we will drink this fruit of the vine with Jesus. It will not be symbolic as we are going to do today. It will be a table where 10,000 times thousands of 10,000 are seated in celebration as the bride of the Lamb. And we will drink again of that fruit of the vine with Jesus in his presence. So we have a wonderful, wonderful future to look forward to. That the bridegroom has paid the price, he is coming again, and when he comes, he will take us to be with him forever and ever. There never will be any separation again. And we'll look more at that message tonight in the rapture. We will drink of the vine with Jesus at the wedding banquet. So today, as we come to the table, where is our heart? Sometimes when we do something over and over again, it becomes a ritual. It becomes a tradition. And we don't really think what we're doing. We just go through the motions. But when we come to the Lord's table, though we may have come hundreds of times before, each time we need to examine ourselves and consider what we are doing. It's not a tradition that Jesus set up that we just come to this table and just do this out of habit. Paul says to the Corinthians, before coming to the table, let each person examine himself. What is our life today as we come to the table? Are we faithful to the Lord? Are we living in expectation of his coming? And joyfully come in remembrance.